Up next, severe epilepsy caused him to lose his sight, but artist John Bramlett has found a way to see life through his paintings.
It's a beautiful day. Oh yeah.
For me, it's expression, but it's also my way of understanding the world. So for painting, for me, it is my eyes, you know, it's my mouth. So that's why I paint so much. That's why because it's my way of seeing things. Like, I don't really feel like I understand something until I paint it, really. I don't know. But it's my way of looking. The great thing, though, about art, about painting, is that it's all about what you can do. You know, it doesn't matter what you can't do in life. You know, it's just a completely creative sort of process, so that it just makes you focus on the positive. I thought I knew what depression was, but whenever I lost my eyesight, I was so depressed, because I wasn't only trapped, you know, inside my apartment, really. I mean, but worse than that, though, I was really trapped in my own mind, my own head. The whole world became a very hostile sort of place. Like, every time I'd leave the house, it seemed like I would get scraped up, bumped. After I was getting around, I was learning how to walk down the street and guide myself that way. I thought, you know, if I could do this down a street, then surely I could guide myself across a canvas. Because my brain knew how to draw and my hands knew how to draw, but that connection between the two, my eyesight was gone. I just had to figure out a way to bridge that again. And turns out that touch is a really good way to get information, especially real-time information from what's around you. And so it was just a matter of relaying what I was feeling, what I was touching, to the images that I would have in my mind, and learning how to touch things and be able to map that out with my hands and form an image in my mind.
Before blindness, John loved to draw. He talks about his first attempts at resuming his passion for art.
It wasn't a very good drawing. I'll be honest. I was more proud of that drawing than any drawing I'd ever done in my life, and it wasn't that great. But I knew through art, if you can do anything, the more you practice at it, it'll just get better. When I first started painting, I would paint 16 hours a day or more. Like, I'd go to school, I would hang out with friends. I learned that from depression. You gotta be around family, you gotta be around friends. So every day I made a point of it, so that I wouldn't get no funk or anything, get depressed. But after that, I'd go home and I would paint, and I would get very little sleep, and I would just paint, paint, paint. And after about 6 months, I didn't even know what would happen. Like, I just suddenly had to, like, I was painting, and I literally put the brush down for a second, because I thought, what is this? And just sort of alien, sort of odd feeling, and I was calm. I felt calm, and I had been so long, and I was happy. And I didn't even know what it was. It had been so long since I felt that way. But it was the painting, because it forces you to live brushstroke to brushstroke. You're only thinking about the paint on the end of the brush and what you're doing right then. You're not thinking about things you've lost. You're not thinking about, like, bills you've got to pay. You're only in that moment. And painting so much, after you leave the easel and the canvas, and you're walking around in real life, you know, your brain just doesn't switch over. You stay in the moment. So whenever I was hanging out with family, you know, if I was visiting with friends, I wasn't thinking, you know, I wasn't as depressed. I wasn't thinking about all these bad things that had happened. I was just enjoying their company. One of the great things about art, about visual arts and applying it to blindness, is that visual artists have been thinking for centuries how to break down the visual world into small little chunks, into ways that you can understand. Which is exactly what non-visual people are doing, like with the orientation mobility. So for me, it's an application of breaking down a composition and combining that. So, like, these visual art techniques with these non-visual techniques that I use for touching. So whenever I'll touch a person's face, I break down the face into different parts. So, like, the ear is broken down into three parts. And those three parts of the ear are broken down into three parts. So you end up with these small little areas of a face that you're feeling, or whatever it is that you're feeling. But you know, like, for that part of the ear, there's a normal sort of curve that it'll make for that one little tiny part. So the only thing you have to remember is, does it follow that normal curve, or does it go above it or below it? You're not having to think about, oh, this is a quarter of an inch, it's a 12 degree angle, anything like that. You're just thinking, is it normal or not? That is so much better than the way a sighted artist has to do it. And I actually teach this technique to a lot of professional artists, because they'll go in and they'll model, and I've done this whenever I was sighted and drew. You would have a model come in, and you would sit there and you would draw them for like 2 hours, you know, every little pose you could think of. I can go in about 10 minutes, I can feel their face, and I have a 3D model in my mind, and I'm good to go. It's good. a lot of times I'll take longer because, you know, you do want to try different, you want them to happy, you know, you want the smile, different things. But if I only have 10 minutes, that's fine. I can get a 3D model of the way a person looks. But it's because it's a mnemonic sort of thing. You know, you're using one thing that just leads into another, that leads into another. And it sounds like it would be hard to remember, like, well, like each little part, but it just leads right into the next one. It's just really easy. Whenever I was sighted, I used to draw in a different sort of way. Like if I did a drawing of a person, like a portrait, like if I was going to do a portrait of you, I would be happy if the portrait looked just like you. And I thought, oh, it's good. You know, oh, this is a good drawing. If it didn't look like you, oh, it's a bad drawing. Whenever I lost my eyesight, it wasn't enough for something to look like a person. It had to feel like them. And I know for most artists, painting, it's expression. It's a way of communicating, and it's a really powerful way of communicating. People, I get emails every day from people all over the world, and they're describing the artwork and what I'm feeling when I did it, almost like they were in the room, and it's incredible to me. I don't say this is a good time to be blind, but this is a great time to be blind. Like, the stuff that's out there is just amazing. I read faster now with my computer than I did when I was sighted. It's just wow. But one of the things, though, there's a program called NVDA, and it lets you go in with a photo with a pixel, and it'll tell you the lightness and darkness of a pixel. So we'll print out a photo, and we'll make it into a raised line drawing so that I can feel the contours and the shape of the drawing, of the photo, so that I understand the shape of it. And then using that program, it'll fill in, like, the lightness and darkness. Like, I have a Marilyn Monroe painting, and it's actually a music painting. The color for her comes from a particular song. So they pulled the color from that song and painted her.
He talks about the process he uses to mix colors.
I mix by how it feels, and also it's like a recipe sort of thing. So that since I can't see color, I have to find other ways to handle color, and because I can't use my eyes. So one of the ways is by doing it but with touch. And that's actually a really precise way of mixing color, because you have like 100 touch receptors on each finger, and they're really good at being able to tell even small changes in the way something feels. So if I want to make a gray that's halfway between black and white, I'll start with a white that's really thick and a gray and a black that's really runny. So I know that the texture halfway between those two is a gray that's exactly halfway between those two. And I can mix the same color each time. And it's almost like a recipe, like a cake. Like you have, if you put all the right ingredients into it, like if you're gonna make a cake, you're always gonna end up with a cake. You're never gonna end up like with scrambled eggs or something. So if I always mix the same colors in the same proportions, I'm always gonna get the exact same color out of it. So if I'm mixing color, I know, well, once I get the blue to this level, and then I'll add, get more in here, 3 drops of this, then it's gonna be a certain shade of blue. I used to use art as a way of dealing with bad things in my life, and I still do, but I also use it to celebrate my life. And more it's a celebration. So if I use somebody in a painting, it's in a way to send a message that I want to talk, and it's usually a very positive message. My paintings have gotten more and more colorful over the years, but I've gotten happier over the years. So the happier I am, the brighter the paintings get. And I only use people that I really like in my paintings, and so So I hope it's a compliment. If I use them, it seems like people are happy with it.
Thanks for joining us on today's episode of Horse Country USA.
And for more information about the stories you've seen here, and for some incredible steals and deals, go to horsecountryusa.net.